Members, it is the appointed time for the meeting and we have a quorum. Let me call the meeting to order. There are 8 papers on today's agenda. Before the meeting, the administration submitted ECI 2016-17 paper 5. That's an information paper for circulation to members. It includes the change of approved directorate posts since 2002 and also the possible impact of these 8 items on the establishment of the directorate grade. I'd like to remind members, if you have direct or indirect interests, that is pecuniary interest related to the items under discussion today, please disclose the nature of that kind of interest before you speak according to ROP 83A. I'd also like to draw your attention to ROP 84 with regard to voting where there is direct pecuniary interest. Last time, we already started the discussion of the first item on the agenda. I'd like to see whether members would like to ask further questions. And this is EC 2016-17, paper 11, Civil Engineering and Development Department, to recommend the with immediate effect the creation of the following 4 supernumerary posts: one principal government engineer, D3, one government town planner, D2, and 2 chief engineers, D1. Until the 31st of March 2021, in order to lead the newly set up Lantau Development Office, and also with immediate effect upon approval of the Finance Committee to reorganize the existing development offices in CEDD and the redeployment of 3 D3, 5 D2 and 13 D1 directorate posts within CEDD arising from that establishment. On the 8th of June, the ESC has started discussion of this item and will continue to do so today. Since we have already introduced the government officials, we are not going to introduce them again. Let's see if members have further questions. Please press the button. First in the line, Mr. Albert Chan. Second round, 3 minutes. Chairman, I said last time that the Lantau Development Office is or can be likened to a Lantau Destruction Office. I shouldn't give you money to create posts in order to destroy our very beloved Lantau, and I have to declare interest. I live on Lantau. I mentioned earlier to the administration that the CEDD and relevant departments cannot even monitor small projects like those in Mui Wo. C&D waste has been dumped on the wetland of Pui O, and even the streams cannot pass. In the past 10 years, C&D waste is causing so much nuisance, even if they are from small projects. If I allow you to set up LDO, whether it be Lantau North, the artificial island, and later on from Mui Wo to Big Wave Bay, and then from Po Lin Monastery to Tai O, the entire marine reserve, which is a treasure, will be affected. The marine reserve is from Mui Wo to Fan Lao. And I also mentioned Pui O. The damage there is already very serious. The EPD couldn't care less. And even government projects are causing problems. Earlier on, the Mui Wo C&D waste has been dumped on Pui O, and there are photos to evidence this. In Mui Wo, there is a demolition project which is about a cover, and it has been dumped on the wetland in Pui O. But you denied it, even if there were photographs showing it. You are dishonest and you are not competent. Now you ask for money to create posts for your officials to be up promoted so you can further destroy Lantau. Well, how can you convince the public that you have the capability to oversee your contractors? And don't tell lies, like the CE. I seldom see professional departments in such a shameless position. You denied facts, even if there was evidence shown in the photographs. The administration, chairman. As I said last time, let me say this again. Lantau development is about development and conservation. An important part of that report, and that should not be neglected, is such that most of the areas in Lantau will be preserved for conservation and green tourism. If you say the LDO is created to destroy Lantau, we will certainly disagree. Mr. Albert Chan mentioned certain places like Pui O, and he may be talking about Sai Yau Tin. Indeed, there is the dumping and accumulation of demolition waste. We said so last time that we knew about it, but we cannot overturn the entire situation within a day. But now if we have the LDO, we will have more manpower, and then we can consider what else we can do. I hope Mr. Chen will understand this. Chairman, he did not respond to my question. Please stand in line. Mr. Liang Yuchong, first round, 4 minutes. Chairman, I don't know whether after Lantau is developed, there will be disaster on Lantau. But now, before you have fully developed Lantau, there are already disasters on Lantau. That is a fact. Let's talk about Tai O. You must have heard, or you must have seen, that until now, people are crying out for help. Why? And that is about bus service. There are so many holidaymakers and tourists in Tai O. I'm talking about weekdays and weekends alike. There are crowds in Tai O all the time, and residents there cannot take a public bus to work or to school or to leave Tai O. And you will say, well, that is exactly because we don't have enough manpower, and that is why we cannot improve the traffic. But that is an excuse. I can't see how you can have the capacity to resolve existing problems before there is more development, and development will bring about more problems. Residents have made very practical proposals for you, but you cold-shouldered them. Like residents said, the buses could be the subject of some interchange midway, but you did not even heed their proposal. And recently, you allowed private cars to get a permit or license to go into Tai O, and the residents were so angry that they actually blocked the road. Chairman, the problems are already there before further development takes place. If there is further development, how are we going to solve these problems? As you said, you did not have enough manpower, and that is why you're asking for manpower before you can resolve these problems. I don't think so. I think it's more a policy issue. Residents have made proposals to you, it's just that you rejected their proposals. Chairman, can I ask this question? If there is more development and problems such as these are going to arise, what shall we do? You pay no heed to public opinion, and later on, if you have this LDO, whether there will be a disaster for you, I like to know how residents can reflect their views to you. Because as I see it, when you have more manpower, there will be more destruction because you don't listen to public opinion. P.S. I will have to clarify. Public opinion matters a lot to Lantau development. From end January to end April, we conducted a consultation. on the first report submitted by the Lantau Development Advisory Committee. Let me talk about Tai O in particular. We understand the situation there. Talking about lining up for buses, I myself was there in the queue for a few hours. The question is, many members of the public love to go to Lantau, especially Tai O, on holidays. And talking about Tai O, my understanding is that apart from its popularity, the bus terminus or bus laybys are not in a satisfactory situation. And we have just submitted a paper to the PWSC to improve the layout there. If it is approved and supported, there will be a lot of benefits for Tai O. And later on, if people would like to go to Lantau and if there are traffic and road problems, as mentioned by Mr. Leung, we have to take an overall look. We'd like to have this LDO so we can take a specific look at bus routes and how they can be improved and where there can be more laybys or parking spaces. I hope we can have a new office so it will be directly responsible and be able to talk to different people, including planners, surveyors, and architects, to see how we can all do better. Next, Wu Chi-wai, first round, 4 minutes. Thank you, Chairman. About this paper, the crux of the problem is not whether there is enough manpower. We know that when there are so many projects planned for Lantau, of course, you need more manpower. The controversy is, why do you have to have an LDO? That is the crux of the matter. The director's post is going to be a supernumerary post for 5 years. We don't know later on whether you would have more specific tasks, and maybe after consultation, maybe you have another plan, master plan for Lantau development. We don't know. The thing is, when you have an LDO, I will have to say this to the PS again, that the concept of Lantau development will be something very hard to explain to the public. Now, since you are going to do coordination anyway, why don't you just subsume it under the Development Office for Hong Kong Island and the Islands? And maybe you can have a parallel supernumerary post to look after Hong Kong Islands and the outlying islands, so you have two persons in charge of that office, and then you can coordinate and promote the projects are in Lantau North, and so that there will not be this impression given to people that actually you are intent on developing Lantau, and this is a shadow cast over the heads of the public. So I now give you some time for the Bureau to tell us whether our proposal is not feasible. You have responded to us to say that by subsuming this under the Development Office, Hong Kong Island and outlying islands, you say this is unrealistic. Why is it so unrealistic? Why is it that if we can have a supernumerary post to also lead the relevant planning procedures, why is it unrealistic? P.S. Chairman, I thank Mr. Wu Chi-wai for supporting the request for more manpower. Well, I have known his different view long time ago. We met, and also at the development panel, Mr. Hu said that he would not agree to the setting up of an LDO. Well, we have agreed on the need for more manpower. And in fact, we need this LDO before we can do our work. Let me say again, this is called the LDO, but it will also look at conservation. We will do both conservation and development. Mr. Wu, you also said that there is a lot of work to do, and it's very complicated and complex as well. Now the work is distributed to the planning department, the CEDD, and some at the development bureau. Other departments are also helping. But if I do not have a dedicated office, it's very difficult to carry out the work. You say we can have two or three supernumerary posts under the development office for Hong Kong and islands. It's very difficult for us to start the work. What is the administrative difference here? You are the administration, and so you are the administration. If there are integrated issues, why can't you take an overall look? P.S. I will answer briefly. Later on, if we have a new office, well, it is going to be cross-sector, and there will not just be people from the CEDD. It's just like previously when we had development of the new towns, there will be planning, architectural, and surveying officials who will be teamed together. If it is still under the CEDD, and even if you have supernumerary posts there, we will not be able to create an integrated team, and so we cannot do our work. So you are saying in the CEDD, Hong Kong and Islands Development Office, you do not have a team? Well, no, that's not what I mean. What I mean is, since conservation and development on Lantau is such an important task, I would really like to have a cross-sectoral team involving officials from different departments. Next, Dr. Fernando Zhang, first round, 4 minutes. Thank you, Chairman. Why is the LDO necessary? Well, we'd like to hear more because all these posts have to do with the LDO. But earlier on, when Zhang Dejiang was in Hong Kong, Mr. Paul Chan, the Secretary for Development, showed him the blueprint for Lantau development, including the so-called East Lantau Metropolis. And all these have direct relationship with these posts. And Mr. Paul Chan's website included all the photos showing all the models and even a model for the artificial island. And we even had islands within islands. Now, had it not been for the uploading of such photographs, people would not have known this. We would not have known that there is already the design and the planning has been done in such detail. The information was not made known to the public, and we asked for that information many times at the council here. Last time, Mr. Albert Chan asked the administration whether that model can be shown to the public. I have yet to hear a positive reply from the administration. I'm talking about the model shown to Mr. Zhang Dejiang. And that is the model on Lantau development. I'd like to know whether that can be shown to the public. Can you do that as soon as possible, Mr. Secretary, or PS?
Thank you, Dr. Zhang, for your question and asking why the model cannot be displayed to the public. I said last time that the model that was displayed, it's the same as the information we showed in that report, except that people are worried that there is an island within the artificial island, and a lot of facilities have been put there in the model. Actually, we don't even have a decision yet regarding the size of the island. The model is only a display. And Dr. Zhang would very much like to see that model. We have actually placed that model onto the website, and the public can actually access that model online. If members want to take a look at that model, we can certainly make the arrangement. I don't know where it was placed last time. I understand that it is now placed at the premises of the CEDD. Of course, we will need to make an arrangement, and then members can go and take a look. I'm sorry. The public would not be able to benefit from such an arrangement. There are many members of the public who are very concerned about this. they are concerned about whether or not we need the LDO and whether or not we need to build this giant artificial island. Regarding the whole environment and the ecosystem and the future development of Hong Kong, this will have far-reaching implications. I don't think you should be hiding the facts like that. I don't know why the model can only be seen after you've come up with some arrangements. You said that you've already put it online or on the website. Could you tell us what is the website? By saying that you've placed it on the website, I don't know exactly what you mean. What are you showing on your website? Is it that you have shown a 3D model on your website, or is it just the two-dimensional diagrams or just a photo? Now, to put it simply, what we put onto our website is the website on Lantau Development. And I think you can search it online. And there is a photo we have displayed on the website, which can be enlarged and reduced in size to show what the model looks like. If you anyone is interested, they can certainly come and view the model through the CEDD. The website is www.land.hk. Could you circulate that in writing to members? Mr. Alvin Young, 4 minutes for your first round. Well, at least the Civic Party is not saying that we won't allow any development of Lantau at all, except that we'd like to know whether or not you've conducted sufficient consultation in the process, or you're just relying on the so-called consultation, you know, of people who already are your supporters. To follow up on Dr. Fernando Jung's point about the model, if Dr. Jung had not asked the question, we wouldn't have known that you have a website. And on that website, I've just gone on that website. Other than a beautiful plan, does it also show the model that you shown to Zhang De Jiang and the rationale for that model? There's no point to show the public the model only. I think you will need to tell the public what is the justification for the proposed development and what is the vision, and also whether you've conducted sufficient environmental impact studies. If so, why haven't you also shown it on the website? And if you have done that, why is it that we don't know? Chairman, on the website you can see the appearance of the model very clearly. If I remember correctly, on the website, on the works for the future, you will be able to see the view the whole model. Mr. Young asked, what are our justifications for constructing this model or the proposal for Lantau development? I'd like to point out that earlier on this year, the Lantau Development Advisory Committee submitted its first working report to the CE, and this is that report. If you ask about the vision for Lantau development and the justification for the proposals, all the details are in that report. Why is it that we think there are opportunities for Lantau, for development of Lantau, and also why conservation is important? All the justifications are there. As to whether or not the public is not well informed of what is happening, I'd like to reiterate once again that at the end of January this year until the end of April, we conducted a three-month consultation. We organized three public fora, and we also conducted a 90-day roving exhibition and a total of 30 consultative sessions. We've consulted, a whole day public hearing in Lechko, also the Town Planning Board, the District Council, the Hung Yee Kok, the rural committees, community organizations, and professional associations, green groups, fishermen groups, and also those who stakeholders in logistics, tourism, and so on. So we organized 30 odd, you know, consulting sessions, and we invited views from all the stakeholders. After that consultation, we received more than 20,000 submissions. We are now working hard to study the inputs we have received and analyzing such inputs. Initially, the response received, the majority of those who responded agreed that we should proceed with Lantau's development. Of course, many people reminded us that in the course of development, we must pay attention to conservation, and we are aware of that. Chairman, what about the objecting views? Have you listened to them carefully? Is there any way you can go back if they don't? I think it is important that you should heed those views in respect of the things that you shouldn't be doing. Well, these are only preliminary views. We do not have any decisions yet as to what we will actually be doing. So any views received, we will consider them seriously. Next, Alan Leung is not here. Leung Yu-chung, 3 minutes for your second round, Chairman. Although our colleagues from the Development Bureau said that they have conducted a lot of consultation and roving exhibitions. But one important thing, the important question is whether or not you understand, you know, what the public thinks. I think the consultation is something you must do, but the question is, what would you do after you've finished with the consultation? According to what you've said, he told us that he's been to Taiwo himself, and he also took him a long time to wait for the bus. And he agreed that on holidays, many people are waiting for buses there. And it's not just on holidays. It's the same on weekdays. I don't know whether you agree or not. You didn't talk about the situation on normal weekdays there. And secondly, how do you resolve the traffic situation there? You say that since the bus terminus there is too crowded, and now you have a plan to improve the bus terminus there. The question is not whether or not whether the terminus is crowded. The question is whether there are sufficient provision of buses. So you're not really addressing the root of the problem. You're not really trying to tackle the problem head on. You're just diverting our focus elsewhere. Even if you were to improve the environment of the bus stop, does it mean that people will no longer have to wait? They will still have to wait for the same amount of time. I said that people have to wait for a long time. You haven't told us why they have to wait for so long. And if you had to take so long to wait for the bus, it would mean that you have not really listened to public opinion. Despite all the consultation that you have conducted, even if you have gone to Taiwo yourself personally, you still don't know how the problem can be resolved. So I'm really worried. You're just, you know, following the instructions, you know, from your superiors, and you simply ignore the sentiment of the people there. So when you're going to set up the LDO, how can you ensure that you will heed public opinion and public sentiments? And how are you going to resolve the problems? Thank you, Mr. Leung. I said that I've been there on holidays. I just want to say that I've been there as a tourist myself to take a look. Of course, during weekdays, I've also been there, but not in my capacity as a tourist, but in the course of doing perform my duties, I've also been there. If Mr. Leung agrees, and I will ask my colleagues to explain why the situation there is so overcrowded. Is it simply because there are not enough buses? Mr. Lam, at the Taiwo bus stop, the question of people having to wait for a long time for buses is because the bus stop I think people are waiting for buses and other vehicles in the same location. For passengers waiting for buses, they have to, they are congregated in the same location where people are boarding and alighting from tourist coaches and other vehicles. And the road there is very narrow. As a result, people are forced to walk on the road rather than on the pavement, and hence it could be dangerous. Tomorrow, we are going to have another project for Tayo, which we will propose, submit to the PWSC. Hopefully, the project, the proposal can resolve the problem. Helen Leung? No, you pressed the button? Sorry, I didn't see that. Albert Chan, your third round, 2 minutes. Chairman, when Zhang Dezhong wanted to look at the model and the blueprint, we would like to see that as well, to see whether the government has lied to Mr. Zhang Dezhong. Well, I'm sure the government has, because the model was not a final decision. So I think the government, we suspect that the government is lying to or cheating Zhang Dezhong, and therefore they dare not display it in public. Last time I took this up with the Secretary of Development, and he didn't have a clear answer. I said, obviously, you wouldn't allow, even he knew that. Lying to the secretary, Jennifer, would be a mortal sin, and that's why he refused to show it to the public. Mr. Leung Yew Chung talked about the traffic situation. If you don't know about the situation there, don't ask the question. I take the Lantau bus every day. I took a bus to Tung Chung this morning, and you never know how long it will take. When the weather is good, you can forget about taking the bus. I've actually talked to the Kun Chung Bus Company chairman, and on one occasion, I couldn't board a bus, in Tung Chung. I asked Kun Chung whether they will deploy one more bus. They said they don't have such an arrangement. I set out at 8 in the morning, and the buses simply, didn't stop. The bus from Tung Chung to Mui Wah, I sent a message to Mr. Wong, the boss of Kun Chung Bus Company, telling him that I'll be missing my ferry, and then I'll be waiting for my electrical meeting. Eventually, I was late for half an hour. For Lantau residents, when the weather's good, they can never attend, board a bus. They will be able to board a bus when the weather is stormy. On Saturdays, you can't board the bus at 6, or 8, or 9, or even 8 in the morning. I had to wait on one occasion for 3 buses to pass by without stopping. And I tried to call a taxi, but again in vain. So you talk about improving the bus station, that is nonsense. The crux of the problem is that we don't have enough buses. I have so much correspondence with the transport department about this issue. Definitely, every time I go to Lantau, the Kai Fongs will scold me and say, "You're a electrical member, you live on Lantau, why is it that we can never board the buses?" Whether it's you're in Changsha or Pui O, in either directions, very often we have to wait for 4 turns and we still cannot board the bus. So what you've told us is rubbish. Can you explain to us why we can't board the bus in the morning? That's because the government is some projects in Pui O, and many of the workers will take the 7:45 bus from Tung Chung. Half the bus is loaded for construction workers, and the bus is full already before it sets out, and people along the way will never be able to board the bus. And Mr. Wong of Kun Chung said, I'm sorry, nothing we can do. But the transit department is not doing anything about it. It's because I'm an electrical member. I know the proprietor of Kun Chung. I complained to him. He immediately deployed one more bus. but the government department has a duty. For such minor projects, you cannot, you know, handle it. You can't even handle questions like transport congestion or you know. So if you don't know about the situation, just say you don't know. Don't pretend that you have the answer. The simple question is, people who cannot board buses along the way in Yunnan Road, we are aware. Well, that has been a problem for many years. So you have chauffeurs to drive you around, but many residents will lose their jobs because they are late for work simply because they can't board the buses. I think the transport problem on Lantau, I think we have received a lot of, you know, submissions and inputs, and that's why we want to set up a dedicated office to really address this problem. I said that we are proposing to provide for more parking spaces that would can actually help the bus companies to expand the service. So let's please give us the time, allow us to the additional manpower so that we can deal with the problem. Thank you. Emily Lau, 4 minutes for your first round. Chairman. Our colleagues have talked so much about the transport situation, and I also agree with them. I think the authorities should know that whether it's the MTRC, buses or taxis, apparently the Lantau is not served by minibuses. For people who want to go there or people who live there, they really are suffering. The government appears to be apathetic or ignorant about the problem. If you know what the situation is like, could you tell us what you will do if you support this project so that we can resolve the problem? So you must at least make a start. Could you tell us? Could you show us that you really have a good grasp of the, you know, transport issue facing the residents there? Permanent Secretary, as I said, we have received a lot of views regarding the transport situation on Lantau Island. For Lantau South, South members already mentioned the problem, especially during the holidays. For the beaches in South Lantau, I won't repeat the same problem again. For Lantau North, we have also received a lot of views and suggestions because the airport island provide many job opportunities. But many people have told us that it's not very convenient for them to travel from Tung Chung to the airport island to work. And the bus routes are not sufficient. For example, the Hong Kong Macau Jiao Bridge, the artificial island there, will provide many employment opportunities. Also, the third runway will be built. After it's built, there will be more employment opportunities. In Tung Chung, we are also planning to expand the new town of Tung Chung. So we need to resolve the transport problem. We can do it, you know, in stages. In the short term, the TD has already done a lot to rationalize the bus routes.
So we've done some work, and we've made some progress. So for the long run, we would need to look at how to connect the future artificial island with the new airport, the third runway, that is after the operation of the third runway, and to cope with the new job opportunities and the demands from new transport infrastructure. So I think there's a need for us to carry out detailed study. Chairman, the DS told us that, actually is he referring to which paragraph in paper which mentions what you just talked about? You talk about the airport. I talked to the airport authority and he said every year there are 3,000 to 4,000 vacancies and yet people cannot, living in Tung Chung, find it very difficult to get to the airport. So it's not yesterday's problem that we're talking about. We've been talking about this issue for years. So where in this paper, please tell me which paragraph says that you will address the problem. Please point it out to me. P.S. In paragraph 10, that is the projects and proposals to be taken forward by LDO, you can see the bullet points there.
In item J, overall traffic and transport study for developments in Lantau, that's what we really want to do, and also do it at an early stage, because we want to look at the overall traffic and transport arrangements, and also to identify short, medium, long-term measures that are feasible. So Chairman, it's like they don't really grasp the whole situation. That's why they need to find money to pay for the post. So in other words, PSU, you're not really not sure what need to be done. But I think we have an idea of the whole situation, but we do need to carry out the study and get concrete data and see which measures are the best. Many people have told us suggestions, so which is the best? We need to look at them by way of a study. Have you got any supplementary information that you can provide us? Well, Chairman, I don't have any concrete overall data for Lantau. So that's why we very much hope to carry out the detailed study ASAP. Chairman, you can't help him. Next one, Chen Kam Nam, first round, 4 minutes. Chairman, just then Albert Chen said that in Tung Chung or South Lantau, there are traffic issues. I'm sure they're real. We all know that Lantau, the roads there are so narrow and steep. People have to go up and down the hill. There are not enough transportation facilities. So in the days ahead, there may be short and medium-term development. We're now in a bottleneck. So because of that, we need to have a dedicated department to really face up to the problems. Besides transportation, planning-wise, development, all sorts of areas, we need to know about the whole picture. Emily Lau just asked about whether we really have a good grasp of the situation. But I think that if we have an office, a dedicated office, then the issues themselves can be tackled individually and we can get enough information about each. If we all know what the solutions can be now, then there's no need to open the office. Therefore, I feel that we need to look at the reality first. And just now, Yu Chong mentioned that, well, even before development takes place, we have got so many problems. So what can we do once the development takes place? So that's exactly why we need to try to address the various issues through development instead of just sitting here and closing our hands. So when we have problems, we need to try to find the solutions instead of just tying our hands and not letting the government add staff or create a new office. I hope that we all can take an active attitude, and we should trust that there will be solutions found, and there will be more solutions than the problems themselves. I support this paper undoubtedly. And in paragraph 10, the more than 10 items listed there for the days ahead, I think for all the issues in Lantau, and these are real work that needs to be done, that's identified in the bullet points. So I hope that members would not, just because of a model that they cannot see. Honestly, the model is just a kind of vision. It's a conceptual image, a vision of some sort. We need to wait till the office is established and then have the consultation and to finalize the whole plan. So if we are to achieve the vision in the model, it takes a lot of time. So we shouldn't, just because we don't see the model, then we use that as an excuse to delay the whole plan of setting up the office. As for the name of the office, where it is, I think that's secondary. The most important is we have to have the office first. Therefore, DAP supports this proposal. PS, any response? I'd like to thank Mr. Chen Kam Lam for his understanding and support. Mr. Chen pointed out our main purpose, that is, we want to have a dedicated and multidisciplinary department which will actually get the work done. Besides development, let me reiterate, conservation is also something that we want to do more on. Next one, Nguyen Quoc Hong, first round, 4 minutes. Of course, well, the model represents a vision, of course, as Mr. Chen Ken Lam said. You gave a dream to Zhang De Jiang, and then he gave you another dream, the dream of One Belt, One Road. We are now living in a world of dreams. It's all talking. The Secretary General, is he like Freud? Is he a dream person who can explain dreams? So for your Tung Chung plan, why is it a failure? You should review it. You came up with a large, created a large Tung Chung community and yet didn't review why it failed. Is it because of noise pollution or air pollution? You didn't do any review over it. Because of your failure, the employment population in Tung Chung is limited and there are not enough jobs there. People have to travel long distance to work in town. But we found that Hong Kong has no history. How many people are living there now in Tung Chung? Just about 100,000. Now you're going to increase it to 200,000. How many people are living there now? I think there's a mistake there. And yet you don't review the situation at all. Let me read from your paper. Our initial plan is to turn Lantau into an area with a population of 1 million in the long run and subject to study findings, public engagement, and statutory procedures. So initially, you have 100,000 people plus, and now you want to turn it into an area with 1 million people. But what if there are only 200,000 or 300,000 people living there? It won't be the first time that you have made a wrong projection. Your previous projection was totally wrong, as it turned out. Anyone went to Expo? How about Terminal 2 at the airport? You now are going to spend billions of dollars to demolish it. We're talking about wastage of money here. Well, I'm not going to have a sumptuous meal. I just want to have a soup noodles with egg and meat. Don't tell me that you want to create a new community with a population of 1 million people. I just want to see bus services there. Enough bus services and taxi services there. Less pollution. And easy for people to get on the train. And people won't have to pay for expensive food. Is that possible? But you haven't achieved that. Survival comes before development. And that's a favorite saying of the establishment camp. And yet, Tung Chung people, they find survival difficult. Are they people of the lowest class, people living in Tung Chung? Albert Chen found that there are some vacant flats in Lantau, but why don't you just move all your government quarters, living quarters to Lantau and come to work at night in town? Mr. Han, would you do that? Don't just try to have grand visions. 1 million people. What are you talking about? We only have 7 million people in Hong Kong, and now you're going to create a new community with 1 million people? I think that's just an empty dream. This is a dream model of dream. Have they reviewed the reasons for the failure of the Tung Chung community now? They have to review and identify the causes of the failure there. P.S. Chairman, I don't quite understand why Lantau co-host that Chung Chung was a failure. He's just saying that there are not that many people living there, but statistically, there are about 18 to 90,000 people living in Chung Chung, and the new Chung Chung town development can only accommodate up to a maximum of 120,000 people. And recently, in the finance committee, we was given the funding to carry out detailed design to expand Chung Chung. And after the expansion is done, in the long run, the population there can grow to 268,000 people. So when we have planning, we need to look far ahead. So including the establishment of the East Lantau Metropolis, it's possible to place 800,000 to 1 million people there. And the East Lantau Metropolis could become the third CBD in Hong Kong. That's the long-term vision. But in the short term, Chung Chung has the capacity to absorb more people. In the medium term, we will carry out the design and the plan to develop a community with 200,000 people. Of all the new towns, in terms of job opportunities, Chung Chung has the best. And we do hope that Chung Chung can provide more jobs in its vicinity so that there will be less demand for transportation. So you are treating what we say as nonsense, right? As Duncan Pilser, the pro-establishment camp, had also said this, that people living in Chung Chung are having a hard time. I'm not going to scold you. Mr. Leung, please wait for the next round. Next one. Tan Kapiu? Okay, you just raise your hand. First round, 4 minutes. I think Long Hair mentioned my name, so I have to speak as well. I think for this post, proposed post, it's not just for Chung Chung, but for the artificial island in Lantau, which may or may not appear. 1 million, it seems like some an exaggeration to me. Another reason for the failure of Chung Chung is you stopped the plan all of a sudden before 2000. You said there would be 20,000 people there, and then the plan stopped. And the primary school there has not enough students, and some mainlander children are accepted or are admitted into school in Chung Chung. If you don't expand the new town, then a lot of community services will be lacking. In 2011, when the SAR government said that they would develop Chung Chung, it's quite ridiculous because we only got the approval for detailed design only this year, after 5 years. To me, I think the pace of development there is just too slow. And there's also an artificial island that may or may not appear. I'd like to ask the PS, excuse me. You do have the function of doing transport planning. For example, the Lantin Tunnel in Cheung Kung Oh, the planning there actually comes under the CEDD in Chung Chung. How about the railway station that would it be built? And also in the last finance committee, we talked about how expensive it was to buy grocery. And the administration promised to look into the provision of a wet market. So would you respond to that? And thirdly, about transportation, no matter how many buses you add, there are some roads in Lantau which are of poor condition. And some residents asked that why don't you just create some north-south corridor? But from your items A to R, there's no mention of such a tunnel. What do you think, PS? Chairman, as for north-south corridor or large-scale transport infrastructure, as I said in paragraph 10, item J, we will carry out a study for the long term. We've heard quite a lot of views on transport infrastructure. So in the near future, once the office is set up, we hope that we can do more study of this sort. As for further expansion of Chung Chung and the planning involved, I would like to get my colleague from the planning department to supplement. I know at the finance committee, there was quite a lot of debate. So planning department, please, who can answer? for Tongcheng, the planning there, community services, facilities, primary and secondary schools, they are actually matched in accordance with the population, in accordance with Hong Kong planning standards and guidelines. We do hope that the provision of facilities will match the future populations there. I don't quite get your response. I'm talking about railway station, wet markets, so you're not really giving me any answers on that. PS, any response? As for the railway station, I know that in the design, there is this provision. Mr. Chung, please, Director. Thank you, Chairman. For the railway station, we have communicated with the relevant government department in Tongcheng East and Tongcheng West for both stations. In our application for funding, for the detailed design, in that paper on detailed design, it's stipulated clearly that there would be those stations. How about provision of wet market? P.S. Well, I wasn't involved in the discussion there. Can anyone respond? Chairman, I can supplement here because at our last Finance Committee meeting, when we applied for funding for the Tongcheng New Town expansion, detailed design for it, our colleagues already answered that question. And we said that actually there would be wet markets within housing estates. And there are already some. And in the future, in some commercial land, there could be a wet market. That's what we said last time. Next one, Wu Chi-wai, second round, 3 minutes. Thank you, Chairman. I just heard from the PS about the list of things, for example, traffic and transport study, and that there will be job opportunities in Tongcheng, and people there actually find it hard to do them because of lack of services. But I'd like to ask, when does CEDD has replaced Housing and Transport Bureau in terms of functions? If the Transport Housing Bureau has not come up with any answer, so why CEDD can resolve it, the problem? I think the more you say, the more we feel that we wonder what are you really trying to get at. For other development plans, policy bureaus are involved, like Tongcheng West, the development in Tongcheng West, some of the land has been allocated to Housing Department and other sites have been put under the work of other departments. So what does the CEDD play? What role does it play? For areas which are under the supervision of some policy bureaus, is it that with the involvement of CEDD, then the development bureau will hand over the site to you? That is, the transport planning in Lantau can be left to CEDD without seeking the approval or idea of Transport and Housing Bureau? Well, I think, Chairman, I never said that I would take over the work of other policy bureaus. In my answer to Mr. Wu Chi-wai's question, I made the point that in new town developments in the past, we adopted the multidisciplinary and focused approach. We will create a new town office.
That new town office would be responsible for different things, as we are saying in the paper, overall traffic and transport studies. We will particularly look at this particular district. Well, please let us know your relationship to the Transport and Housing Bureau. How will your work be different? When we do our study, we will be taking the lead in doing this detailed study, but when we have to deal with other districts as well, we'll certainly coordinate with the TH Bureau. That will certainly be done. If we have this office, we can dedicate our attention to the new town. It's not just the new town, it's about the entire Lantau. We'll be able to look at the overall traffic and transport issue to see what problems there are and whether we can do something in the short term to serve the existing population. As members said, there are job opportunities, and yet those jobs are not filled. And then in the long term, there may be transport infrastructure that can be built. And after that study, we can expedite those. Mr. Chairman, hearing from the PS, does it mean that for a very long period in the past, the TH Bureau has been negligent of its duties, so we need the LDO in order to improve traffic and transport for residents in Tung Chung? PS, I never meant that. But then that is what you have said. The logic is when there is a major development, we need a dedicated office to do the job. Next, Dr. Fernando Zheng, second round, 3 minutes. Thank you, Chairman. Just now, the PS asked us to visit a website. I visited it. It's just a picture. It is not a model. Even if it is a 2D plan, we have been able to see more. We have seen an island within an island. We could see the scale of the island, which is not small. And next to Heiling Chow, there is reclamation. And in Ping Chow, there will be reclamation. Altogether, that adds up to a big area. If you look at the entire Lantau, and also reclamation in the middle part of the sea, it is of quite a big scale. The paper says that you expect 1 million people to live on Lantau, and you are going to add tens of thousands of people to Lantau. In Tung Chung now, we have 80 to 90,000 people, and the PS said you have got money to make long-term plans for Tung Chung, and in the end, the population horizon is 269,000. Last time, we already said that we were worried. There is this big blind spot in your planning process, and that is you don't look at the social needs. Talk about Tung Chung. There is a problem with the wet market. We asked you whether there will be a wet market, would there be a public market? You have not come back with an answer. You have not promised us that there would be. You said you reflect the view. And then we asked about health welfare services, including home for the elderly. And then now we know there will be two. Okay, I grant you that each will provide 300 places. But then on a basis of 270,000 people, if 20% of those are elderly people, and now the home residence rate is 6.7%. Okay, I grant you that it will be reduced a little. At least we need a big number of home places for the elderly. Now you only plan for 300, but in the end we need 2700. And I have asked you where will be the remaining places come from, but you have not been able to give an answer. Now you say you want the LDO, you create posts, you also have a town planner doing the work, but you are only concentrating on commercial, tourism, traffic and transport matters. What about those people who are living there? Well, first of all, I don't know where you are going to move so much population into Lantau. If I could refer to population projections for 2014 all the way to 2064 released by the Census and Statistics Department, in those 50 years, we'll have an increase of just 500,000 people. But then, by 2043, we will have 1 million more, but then the population will shrink. And then by 2064, there will just be 7.1 million people. And now we already have 7.2 million. Therefore, I don't know how you calculate the population projection and whether that can dovetail with the projected developments. P.S., can you respond? Thank you, Chairman, for giving me the opportunity to comment on the figures. Dr. Zheng mentioned the population growth figures. But as I said, we have about 7.2 million people in Hong Kong. And by 2043, there will be an increase of 1 million. This is our projection. But we should not only look at population. we should also look at the population per household, and we expect the household size to reduce. By 2044, there would be 500,000 households more. And what kind of concept is that? That is, we may need a few Shatin-size new towns. And let us remember that the per capita living space is very small. It is like 100 square feet. It's a very small number. For a few years, we have not done any planning for long-term new towns and where they should be. As Dr. Cheng said many times, in the artificial island area, well, actually, we mentioned that 30 years ago, we looked at the waters in Hong Kong and where reclamation can take place. We can't do it to the east. And to the west, there is already a lot of infrastructure being undertaken. And actually, at the place of the artificial island, it is right between Lantau and the metropolitan area. And it is about 4 kilometers in size, and we can link it up with infrastructure. And if we can have hectares of reclamation from the sea, then we can have some solution space so that we can house the new population and also inadequate housing for residents now. Dr. Cheng is very worried about homes for the elderly and with aging of the population, how we can provide complementary facilities. But if we do not have land, we'll not be able to do anything. I hope we can cast our sight to a wider horizon so we can do what needs to be done. Ms. Chen Yunhan, first round, 4 minutes. Chairman, at the relevant panel when the project was discussed, I said I would agree to creating the supernumerary post. Well, actually, this morning we went to Po Toi Island. There is this case at Po Toi Island. It's very difficult for people to access the pier. There is not a road leading to the pier, and private land is involved. This morning, together with the district office, well, it came to LegCo to say the 30 million has nothing to do with them. And three members, together with Ray Chan and Leung Yu Chong, we went to Po Toi Island. And then we found that there was this natural bridge taking people there, but it would exceed 30 million. And then what happens? The district office said they could not do anything. And then the three of us said, let's give it to the Development Bureau. I have been working on land issues for 20 years, but I think it's worst when a project is taken care of by a few departments and we have to go from one department to another. Well, it's all right. It's our duty to do it. But the thing is, we have to get something done. Like this morning, we cannot get anything done, and I don't know whether we can get this particular thing done within the session. Therefore, in terms of planning and development, very often many departments are involved. So if there is a coordination office, if we can have the LDO, I would support it. By the same token, we can say this for other problems. We said we should have some coordination done at the highest ranks. Recently, Mr. Felix Chong, Mr. Yu Si Wing, and myself are concerned about employment in Shem Shui Po. There are cloth sellers who are driven away, and we have been trying to help them. We have found that there is a good flyover or footbridge. Now, they belong to the jurisdiction of the CEDD Bureau, the Development Bureau, or even the HAB. Now, so what should we do? And again, I contacted the highest rank of accountability officials. And members will know this if you have done the same thing as I did. If we can go to the PPC, headed by Mrs. Carrie Lam, then that would be good. And that is why we could do a good job with the Eastern Bypass. That is because Carrie Lam headed it, and then now we have energizing Kowloon East. So I understand members' worries. If there is this coordination office, you know, Lantau is very complicated. We have the north and south and the artificial island, and there is a big area involved. It's very complicated. Now, I understand members' worries. Once you give them the green light, they will do anything they like. But then we should choose the lesser of the two evils. If we can have some coordination, it will be better than now. Now you have to go to different departments for something to be done. I don't belong to this committee. I am saying this here, and Ms. Alice Mack, my colleague, will also be rushing back to state our views. The administration, you have to take care of the worries of members. Later on, you would like to have this artificial island. I myself don't really buy that idea, and this is also the worry of members. But in any case, if there is a coordination office overseeing a complex project, I support it. P.S. Chairman, I'd like to thank Ms. Chan for her support and understanding. About the artificial island, it will be realized only after 2030. I understand. Many members have worries and whether there will be ecological impact brought about by the development of the artificial island and whether navigation of vessels will be affected. Members may have all these worries, but we have to do more detailed studies first, and we need to listen to the public. And I hope we will all look forward if Hong Kong is to develop in the long term. Would that be a good choice? Mr. Leung Yew-chung, 2 minutes of that round. Chairman, when we talked about Tai O and the time taken to wait for buses, the PS said the bus terminus is not a good terminus. We'll have to improve it. And then we said he was not really addressing the issue. And then he said he would need the LDO to improve the traffic situation. If I can go to paragraph 10 of the paper, there are 12 areas of work. The only one that can be linked to traffic and transport is F. It says strategic studies for artificial islands in the central islands. Or actually J, overall traffic and transport study for developments in Lantau. I don't know how that can help Tai O. And also, when the PS answered Ms. Emily Lau, I don't know whether he did it deliberately. What did he do? He said transport and traffic is not ideal on Lantau, so you need the LDO in order to tackle the situation. Mr. Chairman, in the past, traffic and transport has not been satisfactory, but it's not because we did not have the LDO, but because officials did not put their heart into finding a solution. Residents have put forward many proposals, and the CEDD could have done something. Just like bus services on Lantau, what did they say in response? They did not address the issue. They did not try to solve the problem. He said, because the roads are not built well, but this has nothing to do with the roads. Come on, if you don't know it, don't say anything. It is because there are not enough buses. You don't want to add more buses, and you are not providing buses for the intermediate stops. You are not addressing the issues at all. And my question for you is, apart from J, you also talk about improving Tai O and Mui Wo. But you don't tell us what the improvements will be. P.S. Mr. Leung pointed out that in future, the LDO will have to be responsible for the overall traffic and transport study under J. We will also have other items of work. And as I said, this has already started in 10G. we talk about improvement works at Mui Wo Tao and Ma Wan Chong. We have already started the work, just like Tai O, as my colleague said. At Tai O, we would like to have some improvement works, which will benefit the public. Bus service is one, and there are others. We are paying attention, and we are going to work at these. You say there are not enough buses. We said after we have the hardware, then we can have the condition to discuss in detail with the bus company and the transport company to see transport department to see how we can improve frequencies. Next one, Mr. Wu Chi-wai, third round, 2 minutes. Thank you, Chairman. The PS said a lot about focusing attention, dedication. I think all these are on the policy level. And the CEDD should be doing coordination after policy bureaus have made their decision. And the CEDD should be the one executing the work. You need manpower for two parts of the work. One, actual implementation of work, because that would be in different areas and you need manpower. So we agreed to that. And then at the bureau level, you may need to rationalize the policies, say, for example, relationship between the Development Bureau and the TH Bureau. You may need to coordinate policies and discuss policies. But you are telling us that having the LDO, you say, that would be the LDO under your bureau, you will be able to rationalize policy conflicts between bureaus. Sorry. Pardon me for my ignorance. I never knew that a department can coordinate policies between bureaus. How come this office, this LDO, can help to coordinate policies? And why is this person not in the bureau? So that you can supervise the work of the CEDD and the planning department. P.S. Chairman, policy studies and coordination will still be undertaken by the Development Bureau, and we have not increased manpower for that. But what we want the LDO to do is, well, in fact, I don't want to repeat myself. I just like to say we need a dedicated office to do planning for Lantau and then design and implementation, whether it be about development or conservation. We like to have a dedicated office. So we have engineers, planners, and other disciplines in an integrated team. And they are not there to do policy coordination. Not at all. There will be a lot of coordination work to be done, but policy-wise, it will still be within the Development Bureau. Well, you are taking us in this maze. If that is what you are saying, even without the LDO, these supernumerary posts can be subsumed under your existing structure. As I said, they can be under the Development Office, Hong Kong and Islands. What's the difference? If you have a small team to do it, it will still be dedicated, even if it is not an LDO. As I said, now the work is scattered around departments, but I would really like planning and the works discipline people could be put into the same team.
Next, Ms. Alice Mack, your second round, and you have 3 minutes. Chairman, I must say once again that I support the proposed creation of this post. As I said last time, I hope that the NDO will not only be responsible for the mega projects for Lantau, whether or not we proceed with these projects and how we do it. I hope the CEDD will engage all the stakeholders on Lantau and listen to the views. But what is important is that we should resolve the problems confronting the residents of Lantau, especially the outdated facilities, for example, the sewage facilities, which have not been, you know, resolved for so many years. So with So will you promise to do all these things which have not been, you know, resolved for so long? Permanent Secretary? Thank you, Ms. Mapp. Last time, I also briefly said that the aspirations of the local residents is something that we are aware of, and we're already working on the solutions. I didn't have enough time to explain in detail what exactly we are doing. Some of our colleagues are already doing something in this regard. Perhaps Ms. Lam Sai Hong from Hong Kong Island can give Ms. Mac the details. During the public engagement exercise, we noted that in many communities and in the rural areas, they also have many development needs. For example, infrastructure, both in terms of infrastructure, the sewage connection, they are lagging behind those in the other districts. So after we've set up the LDO, part of our duties is we would like to see whether we can do something so that people living in these remote areas will be able to take care of the needs. We will have a small team to explore how we can help those living in the rural areas or the remote areas in terms of improving their transport and infrastructure facilities, such as the sewage, drains. Because if we could resolve those problems, it can help improve the environment, and also it would also help in terms of conservation. After we've created the LDO, we will continue with such efforts. Any further follow-up? No? Mr. Chen Hang Ban, your first round, and you have 4 minutes. Thank you. The LDO, after it has been set up, it will need to follow up on a lot of work. You need to develop Tung Chong, Siwa Wan, and Sunny Bay, and also the Hong Kong Macau Dry Bridge, and a lot of work in terms of conservation, and also improvement work for Tai O, Mui Wah, Ma Wan, and so on. So I therefore support your proposal, but I hope that after you've set up the LDO, you will do a good few things. And we've already touched on this many times before. First of all, Tung Chong. For Tung Chong residents, if they want to work, go to the airport to work. It will take them longer than those people living in Tsing Yi traveling to the airport to work. As a result, a large number of people have to actually go outside of Tung Chong and then take a bus back to the airport. Tung Chong rest. So this actually, there is actually a mismatch between where these people live and where they work. So I think what you need to do is to improve the transport connections with the airport. I had proposed that you should develop a light rail system connecting with the airport and a few major areas, because that can really facilitate the future development of Tung Chong. You project that the population of Tung Chong will increase to 260,000. So we think that these are the things which you should do. So I really hope that after the LDO has been set up, it will look into this. Secondly, for those in the remote areas, like Phat Mong and so on, the residents there have told you many times that on Cheng Tung Road, they want a junction which can help them connect with the high-speed highway. But you do not allow them to do that. So they see the road passing through the village, but they cannot link up with the express highway. So I hope that after you've set up the LDO, you can do something and look into such details, so that while you can undertake all these mega infrastructural projects, you should also take care of the needs of those living in the remote areas. PM? PS? Mr. Chen, we are aware of the concerns expressed by Mr. Chen. During the public engagement exercise, people have told us about the transport and infrastructural issues in Tung Chung and the neighboring areas. As I said, we receive a lot of inputs. We are now processing the inputs we have received. I've also said that we hope we want to set up the LDO as soon as possible so that they can conduct a comprehensive transport study for and traffic study for Tung Lantau. Mr. Chen referred to the difficulty for people going to work from Tung Chung to the airport. Actually, for the Lantau artificial island where the Hong Kong-Macau dry bridge will land, we have already engaged a consultant engineer to study the feasibility. For remote areas like Bak Mong and so on, we know about the aspirations of the people living there. So we take a comprehensive look and see, we will consider short, medium, and long-term solutions. Albert Chen, 1 minute for your fourth round. Chairman, when I criticized the administration, I said that other than the transport issue, I said that the CEDD had not been able to, you know, supervise the projects under its portfolio. The CEDD said that after they've conducted a study, that the transport situation will improve. But looking at what the CEDD has done in terms of the lack of supervision of the projects under the portfolio, they have not really responded. Why, if you have so much confidence on improving the transport situation there, why don't you, you know, work for the TX Bureau? I'm not just talking about buses. Sometimes Muyo residents cannot even board the ferries where many tourists go there. And this is a common occurrence. Chairman, Mr. Lam Kok Hong asked a very important question which the PS has not answered. Perhaps he didn't understand what Mr. Lam was asking. If you look at the Tung Chung, the development of Tung Chung, in 1997 and 1998, the plan was that by the year 20-something, the population will go up to 0.6, 0.7 million. By 2010-something, it will be 0.3 million. Tung Chung was going to be developed in three phases. But subsequently, because of the noise pollution, the development of Tung Chung was brought to a standstill. And then when CYLM became the CE, the administration suddenly woke up and wanted to expand Tung Chung's population to more than 200,000. And there has been no explanation. The secretary doesn't know about the noise nuisance, you know, generated by the aeroplanes. And now you tell us that, since we're going to build the third runway and so on. But you have not really given us an explanation. I've been asking the administration since 1998 until now. I asked the CAD and the airport authority to give us information as about, you know, the details, and other than the consultancy report on the third runway, they've not really even given us the answer. And they were trying to hide the facts in order to avoid litigation. Given the runway at the moment, if it's become the 2025 NEF, then it's against the guidelines, and people can actually, you know, lodge claims. The government is hiding the facts. I think I still have many more questions to ask. Mr. Chen talked about the development in the 1990s. He was probably talking about Taiwan. No, it's Tung Chung. Why don't you read that report? The original project plan to develop Tao to accommodate 50,000 people, that plan was scrapped. You look at the government's plan in 1995, phase 1, 80,000 people, 2012, 2013, population for Tung Chung is projected to go up to 300,000. P.S. Other than Tai Ho, and Tung Chung is also going to be developed in phases. Mr. Chen said there have not been any interim review. I'd like to remind Mr. Chen that in 2004 and 2007 for the Lantau Development Plan, we did mention, refer to the development of North Lantau. We are bringing this up again because there is a strategic value for the development of Lantau, so we're looking at it in a comprehensive manner. Tung Chung development has already started. Phase one has been completed. Obviously, the PM doesn't know. He doesn't know about the government's plan regarding the development of Lantau in 1998. He doesn't seem to have access to such information. If you're willing to go online and look up the information, you will know. He has no grasp at all of the information. I'm shocked by the PA's ignorance. Since he is responsible for the development of Lantau, he doesn't know the history. And he has no knowledge of the historical background. As a result, these problems are still persisting to the detriment of the residents. P.S., if you don't know, I can show you and give you the information. I'll show you what was the decision made in 1998. To respond to Mr. Chen's point, Mr. Chen is very worried about the NEF 25. Regarding the further expansion of Tung Chung, we've already said that we've already conducted the EIA study. That was in reference to the third runway. The third runway will be implemented 6 or 7 years from now. What is the 25 NEF? That has never been disclosed. Please go back and look up the information today. That is right now for the existing runway. Where is the information pertaining to the 25 NEF for the existing runway? Leung Yu Chong, 1 minute. The PS said that to resolve the transport problem on Lantau, according to Jay, they say they will conduct an overall transport and traffic study for the development in Lantau. As I said, this is only a study. There is no specific plan as to when the recommendations of the study will be implemented. We don't have a timetable. We don't even have the roadmap. Could you tell us whether you have set a timetable or roadmap, if indeed the LDO had been set up? Secondly, I'd like to know whether or not we are now waiting for the result of the study, and meanwhile you're not going to address the transport problem on Lantau. Thirdly, for G, improvement works at Muo Tayo and Ma Wan Chung. You're going to put this under transport improvements. Could you give us the details? What are such improvement measures? Three questions. I'll try to be brief. Timetable. I don't think we have a detailed timetable for Lantau Island overall. We hope that by the end of this year, we'll be able to complete the first blueprint for Lantau. Hopefully in that blueprint, we will have some timetables. Mr. Leung is concerned that if we are waiting for the study to be completed, we'll do nothing meanwhile. Well, that's not true. I said that in the near term, if there's anything that we can do, we will do, and subject to the constraints, we will do the best we can. His third question was about the improvement works at Muo Tayo and Ma Wan. I can't give you a short answer. If there is time, I can ask my colleagues to give members a detailed briefing. Fernando Jiang, your third round. First of all, let's follow on what the PS said just now. That is planning for the social needs. This apparently is a blind spot at the moment. You simply have not been able to respond to the needs of the community, whether it's the demand for the services of homes for the elderly, education, health, culture and conservation. All these details are missing in your plan. Your proposal to create the directorate post will include the creation of the post of town planner. In your plan, will you include these social needs? Of course, they are provided for under the Hong Kong planning standards and guidelines, but these guidelines have not been able to catch up with the changing needs of our society. So the part about social need is very scanty, including, for example, wet markets. That's gone. And last time I mentioned also the preschool children with SCNs and the facilities to cater for these children has not been included in the plan. So you've not changed the times. As our society develops, we have different social needs appearing and different demand for new services. So according to Hong Kong standard planning standards and guidelines, the guidelines have not been amended. So I'd like to know whether you are prepared to amend the Hong Kong planning standards and guidelines, you know, in line with social changes. The planning standards and guidelines of the planning department will be reviewed from time to time. And it will also be reviewed according to the change, in the light of changes. When we consider the development of Lantau, the question is whether or not we are concerned about the social needs. As I can tell Dr. Jeong that social need is an important part of our social planning. If I have time, I can ask my colleagues to explain in greater detail. For the Lantau Development Advisory Committee, the work that it has been doing so far, I think they have prepared some papers on social development, and they have been put onto our website. When Tung Chung was first developed, for example, some people said that there was insufficient employment opportunities. But according to the data and in our social development papers, one can see that in Tung Chung, the unemployment rate now is about 3.1%. The overall unemployment rate for Hong Kong is 3.4%. We've compared the education facilities, hospitals, and open space in Tung Chung. A subcommittee under the Lantau Development Committee had a thorough discussion on the subject. For example, since the commissioning of the Tung Chung Hospital, they say there has been major improvements for some district facilities. Because we know that in some areas they have been under provision, but as far as schools are concerned, we have sufficient provision. Some schools even have, you know, spare, you know, capacity. For some schools, the situation is comparable to schools in other districts. In the development of Tung Chung East, we are considering whether or not we can provide additional education facilities to make up for any shortfalls on wet markets. We note that some people have pointed out that we should provide for more wet markets, and this is something that we'll do at the next stage. In terms of social development, if we compare Tung Chung with the rest of Hong Kong, I think the situation in Tung Chung now is not bad. There's a lot of work at the front line that needs to be done, and we have a strategy that is in future in terms of educational facilities. We can provide for new facilities on North Lantau to make up for any shortfalls. For social development, we've also looked at the remote areas and find out what facilities they lack. And in the relevant discussion and the papers, you'll find that we have an extensive, discussion. But if we were to study in greater detail as to what we need to do in line with social development, in the blueprint for Lantau development, we have plans to take a further look into what needs to be done at a district level, and we'll work together with the relevant bureaus in this area. If there is a need, then we hope that the LDO will do a good job in terms of the blueprint.
We will coordinate with other bureaus. Next one is Albert Chen. With round 1 minute. Okay, well, it should be Lam Kwan Hong's turn. Second round, 3 minutes. Chairman, there are two views expressed today. One is that, we need to address the outstanding problem, mess left in Tung Chung, a community with a projected population previously of 200,000. Now the population has shrunk, actually stands only 80,000. And now you're trying to add back to the population. But if there are as many people as projected in living in the area, then what would be the transportation burden be like? And how about the railway service? Do you find it very convenient going to places from Tung Chung? Electrical members actually who used to live there have left. So either you made a mistake initially and now in trying to fix the problem, you said that, well, you only fix it if there is a joint Lantau development plan. We're talking about a massive change here. Creating a new office to coordinate the work, a big project. The two views on it, that is for a big project. Well, how are you going to resolve this Tung Chung issue? We haven't seen any answer. And you haven't got any answer for the big project itself. Can we just finish, say, a set of dim sum bit by bit instead of swallowing the whole thing? Well, you have the CY Leung who actually imposes the order. He wants to have a big leap forward plan and trying to help with upper mobility. And if electrical is devoted on it, if it doesn't support it, then electrical will be seen as blocking his way. But is it really necessary for us to have this empty scheme to actually make this big plan stand out? We may not agree with setting grade A commercial offices there, or office space there. We've seen a lot of empty shops and spaces already. Commercial rents are falling. So every time it's like this, you came up with giant projects, you won't go for small ones. Can you submit the plan to it bit by bit? Is it necessary for you to submit the whole big project to us in one go? CY Leung is stepping down, and what about the next chief executive? We've seen the example of the West Kowloon Cultural District. Well, because of this joint plan to develop West Kowloon Cultural District, and then now we have this mishmash project in the end. So can you submit your plans to us bit by bit instead of bringing in massive changes? P.S. I think Mr. Leung was asking about the time frame for the long-term plan. Actually, in the Lantau Advisory Committee, Development Advisory Committee, in its meeting early this year, it actually talked about how it's going to get the works done in stages. The East Lantau Metropolis, we are talking about actually bring it into reality by 2030. So we have preliminary conceptions for the long and short medium term. We're going to come up with a blueprint for Lantau by the end of this year. But it's a big change, you know, creating office blocks there. You're saying that you're going to have 5 office blocks there. That will be a major change from the existing plan. Okay, point taken. Next one, Fernando Zhang, 4th round, 1 minute. Chairman, last time in the Finance Committee, I said a lot about the planning issue in Tung Chung. I'm not going to repeat it. Just then I heard, from what I heard from the officials' office, that they didn't really hear what I said. Last time, I pointed out about facilities like rehab, special schools. There's long waiting list on them, and you can see the laziness on the social welfare department website. We're talking about waiting lists of months and years. And my estimate is that for the disabled or people in need of rehab and care home for the elderly, the existing planning cannot really reach these people stuck in the long waiting list. So the Lantau Development Advisory Committee, as you said, has had in-depth discussion, but obviously there are still huge blind spots there, so please make reference to my views expressed last time. Okay, I heard Mr. Jones' points. Next one, Wu Chi-Wai, fourth round, 1 minute. I was asking you to incorporate this Lantau office into the Hong Kong Island Development Office, and yet you can't do that, you said. But if you look at the plan, all the outlying island districts are going to come under the terms of reference of the Lantau Development Office. So if the Hong Kong Development Office will only be responsible for Hong Kong Island, then compared to other development office, then the Hong Kong office will be of a very small scale. What's the rationale for that? There are development offices, and we have directorate staff at all the offices, each office. So what's the point of compressing the work of the Hong Kong Development Office by such a big extent? So why is the Hong Kong Development Office, can relatively speaking, compared to the Lantau Development Office, you know, can be of a similar scale to it? Okay, I think there are details in the paper, but I can ask the director to explain to you more. Understand the workload of the development offices, but we have the existing office head here, so maybe I can ask him to explain why there's a need for a dedicated office. Thank you. Mr. Lam? Mr. Chong? Well, in this Lantau office that we are planning to set up, well, it will help develop Lantau and also support the conservation there. And we're also trying to seize the opportunity here, since that over the past few years, other development offices, because of the implementation of various projects, some offices actually have seen rising workload beyond what their existing manpower can afford. Therefore, we're trying to seize this opportunity to review the work of the four development offices and redistribute the work among them. Yeah, member has said it right. The existing Hong Kong Island and Outlying Island Development Office will actually outsource the work of Lantau and Outlying Islands. So in our current planning, the Development Office will be responsible for all the work, and there will be a South Development Office in the future. The South Development Office will be responsible for Sham Shui Po, Yao Chin Mong, and four districts on Hong Kong Island, altogether six areas covered by six district councils. Particularly for Yao Chin Mong, West Kowloon Cultural District. Well, actually, over there, there's a lot of work remaining to be done. So, on the whole, for our South Development Office, its workload will not be less than that of other development offices. Okay, next one. Albert Chen, fifth round, 1 minute. I think if you can still recall, when the government set up the Airport Coordination Office, it was set up because there was the push for the implementation of the 10 core infrastructures. So there's Mr. Su, who is responsible for the airport work. And now, for the entire Lantau development plan, the consultation paper, as the Secretary said earlier on, there have been a number of consultation forums on the topic, but I'd like to point out that many of the consultation forums actually were attended by, 80% of the attendees were people in support of the airport authority. Basically, they were in support of the idea. the environmental groups, residence groups in Lantau could not be registered for the consultation forum. So those forums were actually manipulated in a way, producing results that were biased towards the government. Therefore, I think the entire plan is something that is imposed, what the government is trying to impose on us. And for this Lantau Development Office, consultation paper is just out, and we haven't known much details about planning. And the plans were only seen by the director, and you are trying to get us to support the new Development Office. Are you trying to play tricks here? You don't even have a consensus on your blueprint for development, and yet you are talking about setting up an office. It's rare for the administration to act like this. The CEY Leung, who used to be in the surveying business, Paul Chen, actually they have conflict of interest in this development plan, and yet civil servants are helping drive the plan for people like them. P.S. I don't agree with Mr. Albert Chen's point that our consultations were fake. Actually, we never turned down anyone. But I think the registration process was manipulated. Well, I totally disagree with your accusation. You can't say that the consultation itself was manipulated, because that would be, well, if that's the case, why are those in support of the government plan managed to register and many residents could not register for the event? Please look at the Tung Chung consultation forum, look at the name list of people attending. Once you look at the name list, you can see that the people there were unanimously in support of the government. Wyke had said that we never rejected anyone because of the overwhelming response. We organized one more consultation forums, and for different stakeholders, we organized 30 forums separately for them. In the 1990s, when the new airport was in the pipeline, there was the NEPCO set up. But now, we haven't come to that stage yet. We are still at a very preliminary stage, conceptual stage. There's still a lot of study that needs to be done before any implementation can take place. So if you compare the proposed office this time to NEPCO, I think that's not comparing apples with apples. In the future, if the large-scale infrastructure is to take place on Lantau, then a similar office of similar scale may be kicked off then. Chairman, will we have any break? Yes, we will. How many minutes would that be? Are we going to the break at 4:30? I think we can wait till Leung Yu Chung asks his questions first. Leung Yu Chung, 1 minute. Just then, the PS said at this stage for transportation in Lantau, they would only act till the consultation study is done. I don't know what he has in mind. But I think it's not just road improvements alone that can improve the transportation links. The number of buses is also very important. The transport department is very well aware of this problem, and Lantau Bus Company does as well. So do we have to wait till your consultation study is done before increasing the number of buses and routes? That's my first question. And secondly, on Tai O Mui Wong and Ma Wang Chung, the improvement works there. I'm not trying to get you to tell me all the details, but at least the big improvement works. Can you give us an idea on what they will be? So I don't want to be told later on, so that residents can have some understanding of what they can expect. P.S. Okay, I'll answer the first question first. And for the second question, on Ma Wan Chung, Tai O Mui Wong, I'll ask my colleague to explain. Please be concise. Actually, I said this already. As for transportation link, we have started doing what can be done at this stage. Ms. Emily Lau just then mentioned between the airport island and Tung Chung, transportation arrangement can be made to improve connectivity. We have discussed with the transport department already to enhance transportation services. If possible, whatever is possible, we'll get it done and get things improved. As for those specific locations, I'll ask the DS to explain. As for Tung Chung, or airport, or the entire South Lantau bus services, we have been following up with short-term measures. For example, under the Lantau Advisory Development Advisory Committee, there is a subcommittee on transportation. In early January, through discussion with the Transport Department, we changed a bus route to Apple Island XS64 to actually divert it to another route. Once we've changed the route, residents have responded favorably. Okay, please be more direct. Tai O, how about Tai O? There are only two bus parking places right now, but we're going to improve that or increase that to four. And after improving the provision of parking spaces, through discussion with Transport Department and the bus company, we will try to improve bus services there. Okay, we have a break after Wu Chiwai's turn. Wu Chiwai, fifth round, 1 minute. Chairman, I said that the more you talk about transportation, the puzzled I am. Because it's the Transport Department that should be responsible for changing bus routes. But how come it's you who are talking about that with us? I don't want to dwell on this, but I just find it very ridiculous. You're saying that after this development, sounds like you can replace the work of the Transport and Housing Bureau. That's just outrageous to me. And you said that the outlying islands and islands town development office have a lot of work to do, but in paragraph 22 of the paper, you talk about the Hong Kong Island and Island Development Office. The major work projects under it are the WDII and associated works for CWB, reassembly of Queen's Pier, Columbarium Development Engineering Feasibility Studies. But honestly, all these items, I think compared to the items A to O identified for Lantau, these cannot really be compared to them. And also for Northwest Development, New Territories Northwest, like in Ho Chi Minh Development Projects, these projects mentioned here cannot really be compared to them. So I really can't see the workload of these projects named in the paper. So PS, I ask my colleague to talk about the distribution of work. Thank you, Chairman and Mr. Wu. Just then I mentioned that with the reorganization, Hong Kong Island and Island Development Office will be renamed Southern Development Office, which will be responsible for Sham Shui Po and Yao Chi Mong in Kowloon. Yao Chi Mong includes the West Kowloon Cultural District. But that the cultural district is under the supervision of the cultural authority. But the authority has its own development of cultural facilities. But for the support infrastructure, which is of quite a large scale and worth up to $10 to $20 billion. So all along, we have been actually applying to Finance Committee for funding. And in later days, we will step by step actually take forward the various works that is around the Western Kowloon Cultural District. There will be connectivity measures, and within the cultural district underground, there will be a large-scale infrastructure to be set up. And in the future, Sham Shui Po will also have its own development works. Lately, we've got the funding to come up with infrastructure for housing development there.
Also, there will be a network of footbridges. There will be many taken together. So, the workload will not be less than other development offices after restructuring. Thank you, Chairman. Now we have a break of 10 minutes. We'll resume at 4:40. Thank you.